to the Saturday show, everybody. Hope you're doing well on this Saturday morning. This is the Saturday show, as I mentioned. I am Jay Catch, joined by Christian Esparza. How are you, Christian?
Doing great.
That's good.
Happy Saturday.
Yeah, happy Saturday, no doubt. Excited to be here, obviously. We're going to talk a lot of different things on today's show, but we've also got two new members of the team behind the glass. We just did a Parker last week. Parker's back behind the glass producing today. And then we also got Brett now with us as well this morning. So how are you two fine gentlemen doing?
We're here on a Saturday morning.
That's what that's a very good point. That's a very good point.
Happy to be here on a Saturday morning, I might add.
Appreciate that. All right, so we got a lot to cover ahead on today's show. We're going to talk some hockey. We're going to talk some Big 12 with Media Days just 3 days away now. Crazy that the entire Big 12 conference, all 16 members of the conference now, are going to be in Vegas in just a few days' time. We got a big old crew here at KSL Sports that's going down to it. We also got some NFL news. Jeez, we got a lot to cover, Christian.
Yeah, I mean, typically summer is like our off season, you know.
Yeah,
but
right.
This summer in particular, it feels like we haven't stopped. And then now, seems like the last couple weeks we've just ramped up.
Well,
so it's always busy.
And that's the funny thing about it. I was talking to somebody actually literally yesterday, and they're like, "So how's your downtime been?" I looked at him, I'm like, "What downtime?
Yeah, what downtime?"
It's been insane, but it's been a lot of fun at the same time.
It's been so much fun. This has been, and I mean, I've only been here a couple, two seasons now, I guess, but this has been such a fun summer to work here in this market.
Sure.
With everything that's going on with hockey and the Big 12, and it's just a constant stream of news, but it's been so exciting.
Yeah, it's been nonstop. There's no doubt about that. All right, so before we really get going here, you got a highlight of the week for us?
I mean, the 4th of July was great. Last
always
night
great.
Was
Come
one
on
of my
now.
Good friend's birthdays, so we went out to a little hibachi dinner. That's always fun.
Okay. Are we talking like Benihana? Are we
talking
teppanyaki?
This place up in Logan, it's called Kabuki.
Okay, I've actually heard of Kabuki.
Yeah, it's really good.
My brother lives in Hiram.
Okay, so. It was fun. We had a lot of fun.
Okay, perfect. Highlight of my week, honestly, was yesterday. Chance to go watch the NHL.
Oh yeah,
and let me be very clear about this. Yesterday was the prospects camp scrimmage for the Utah Hockey Club over at the Delta Center. So this is not the top shelf talent of the franchise, but this is the future of that franchise. A lot of these guys, they may be 2 or 3 years away in certain circumstances. Maybe some as many as 5, depending on how they progress through the minors. But really cool to finally see a group of athletes associated with the Utah Hockey Club on ice in the Delta Center.
Right, wearing the Utah Hockey Club jerseys.
Yeah.
And, I mean, for us here in Salt Lake City, that's our first taste of the NHL.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that was very exciting to get out and go see. And from what I heard and seen, it sounds like it was an incredible event. Everybody had a lot of fun, and they're just getting everybody hyped.
Yeah, they are, and so let's start there. Let's just dive right in. Biggest thing that I took away from it is this is going to be a really interesting debut season. And what I mean by that is that there is going to be an excitement factor that's going to override wins and losses, I feel like.
Right.
Meaning, okay, you win, you lose, great. The excitement factor of just having the NHL in Salt Lake City will override a lot of that, at least year one here. The interesting part to me is going to be, okay, is this club winning at a pretty decent clip? Because there are projections out there. I saw one yesterday that said they are projected to have 90 points next season, which would put them right on the fringe of making the playoffs. Reading up on that a little bit further, apparently if you get to like 95, between 95 and 100 points in a season, you're pretty much guaranteed to make the Stanley Cup playoffs.
So when you say points, you're talking like soccer point system,
yes,
right?
Yes, so hockey has that too, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so
want to clear that up for any listeners that might be confused.
The way that these NHL teams get points, I'm still not 100% certain
on
all the different ways.
So it's not like 3 points for a win.
There are.
Okay, okay.
But there are other ways. Like I think there's like something like with like overtime games.
Oh my goodness!
You can get points out of this. It's a.
It's interesting.
We're gonna learn a lot.
So I'm gonna be honest, and I think that's the realistic scenario, right? Fringe playoff team. That's about what they were last year.
Yeah.
They started winning down the stretch kind of when they found out that they were coming to Salt Lake City
after
they
got past a 17-game losing streak,
right,
because of all the nonsense going on.
So that's the interesting thing to me. Once it got finalized that they were moving, it seems like they got revitalized and went on this little – they closed the season on a hot streak, right?
Yes.
So there's a part of me that wants to think, and of course it's just me being a homer, but I definitely want to think that being here in Salt Lake City, playing in front of a sold-out Delta Center, the fans, the excitement – of the first season, night in, night out, I think that's going to add a little bit of extra juice. And whether I'm not saying that that's going to make them a contender by any means, but I would say that it's safe to say that they're going to be contending for the playoffs.
Well, yeah, and here's the thing. Watching the Stanley Cup playoffs, just get in and see what happens.
Right.
Because it's a pretty it's a playoff structure, and just the way that hockey goes is that if you catch fire – there's no reason you think you can't make an incredible run. There are a lot of people that thought the Edmonton Oilers weren't going to make a very deep run.
No, and we see that all the time in any postseason, in any sport. I mean, sometimes you'll get underdogs that make it all the way, and you're like, these guys, I couldn't even believe that they made the playoffs and they're in the finals. So that happens, and I'm not saying that by any means, but just the fact that the excitement and the energy, adding a little bit of extra juice to the players, I think, I mean, I would be honestly surprised if they don't make the playoffs year one, if I'm being honest. And I don't know a ton about hockey. I'll be up front. Like, we're all still learning.
Oh, we're learning, yeah.
But I would like to think that the players, the organization, they are really excited to be here, and that's going to you're going to be able to see that on the ice.
Sure. Well, okay, and the other thing about it is watching yesterday's event, and we got an email last night saying that roughly 3,000 fans were in attendance. So it was
on a Friday at 1 o'clock, and I know a lot of people had work off.
Not everybody, though.
But not everybody. Yeah. So, 3,000 people, 1 o'clock on a Friday, that's a really good turnout.
It was a pretty lively crowd, all things considered. Now, the upper bowl was not open, and that's the whole thing with the way that the rink is structured right now. If you go into the Delta Center with that ice down, there's a good 3,000 seats that usually are like right around the court for NBA for the Utah Jazz that are not going to be utilized right now just because they can't.
Right, because of the ice.
The risers can't come out. And so the interesting dynamic of this upcoming, and for however long, because the timeline on revamping the Delta Center is 3 years, give or take. It's got to get a lot of mumbo jumbo legally and with the state government and everything out of the way. But the bigger thing is I think that the upper bowl, once that's filled with fans, it was a pretty decent environment.
Oh, yeah.
But with the fans on top, because you know how the Delta Center is built. It's like straight up.
Yeah.
The sound just rains down on you. With that upper bowl filled, it is going to be a raucous environment.
Well, and that's what Delta Center is kind of known for. Yes. And we've seen it with the Jazz, and obviously not recently because they haven't been doing as great. But, I mean, the Delta Center has been known for being one of the loudest venues in the NBA.
Well, it's been sold out even with all the struggles the last two seasons. It's been fairly – I've been to conservatively 10 games over the past two seasons for Utah Jazz stuff.
Yeah.
And each one of them, it's still fairly – but it's not the fever pitch it once was. I'm with you on that. But it's still very, very loud.
So you throw in the added, excitement, hoorah of this new sport that everybody's fascinated with. I think it's going to be a blast. And I know that ticket prices are up there a little bit, but I'm hoping to get to at least a game or two. I mean, it's hard with how busy we are with everything that we do here at KSL Sports. But
here's a little tidbit. You're in the media now.
Right.
You can get things called a media pass.
Yeah, that's true too. Yeah, exactly.
I'm just saying. No, the other thing about it is yesterday, it was TJ Ginla was on the ice yesterday. By the way.
Yes.
Buy stock now. I'm a bit of a neophyte when it comes to hockey, but him single-handedly driving up the ice and just the moves he was putting on, I'm like, I get it.
There's a reason he was 6 overall at 17 years old.
Yeah, kid has got moves. His dad's a Hall of Famer.
Yeah.
Like, the bloodlines are there.
That's crazy. And one of my favorite things, great coverage from Kyle Ireland yesterday and many other people here with the team. But
here's the thing. I was over there. So our group yesterday, we had Sam Farnsworth from KSL Sports Live, our TV product, Kyle Ireland and Jay Stevens on the KSL Sports.com thing. I guess I technically was representing KSL Sports Zone. We had a good representation.
Yeah, so I've seen a lot of stuff on social media, a lot of clips of these guys, and TJ Ginla and Cole Bedouin,
yeah,
seeing them after this little scrimmage, the biggest thing I noticed with them is they're all smiles. I mean, they're young kids. They're happy to be here, but they're also excited to put in the work, and I think that's extremely evident. And I would definitely recommend watching these little post-game kind of interviews. They're real quick. They're nothing really official, but I mean, it's clear that these kids are like super happy to be here. They're excited. They want to get to work. And I mean, I already love these guys. They're like, I'm just looking at this one. Like I said, TJ Ginla right now, he just got a huge smile on his face. He scored a goal in this scrimmage.
And the funny thing is the goal he scored, there were three or four other chances that he did not score on. I was like, I'm just like jaw dropped on the table in front of me. I'm like, wow, that kid's got moves.
Yeah, no, he's great. Can't wait to see him. Hopefully it's not too long before we get to see him on the ice.
Him being 17 years old, as I understand it, the timeline for him is probably two seasons at the soonest.
Yeah.
Because he's got another year, it looks like, in the juniors or the minors, as most people call him, and likely one other year, maybe AHL or something else.
He said after he got drafted, he said his goal is to be playing for the Utah Hockey Club when he's 19. So, yeah, well, two years, that checks out.
The other thing about it is it was a really cool thing to see it happening, because I was talking with some of the people involved on the team. So the other on the, so not the media side, from the team side yesterday, right, after the event got over, and they were talking, yeah, we're 60 some odd days from training camp again. And I looked at them. I'm like, you guys going to get this all done? Like, yeah, the on ice product, that won't be a problem.
Yes. No, everything behind the scenes that nobody knows exactly what goes
business
on.
Business side, media relation, that whole stuff, that's all going to be built
up. Oh, the branding, the marketing, the merchandise, even for the temporary stuff. Like, there's a reason it has to be a temporary logo, is because there was no real way that they could get the permanent stuff ready in time for the season.
Which, by the way, the current look of the Utah Hockey Club and the branding, totally okay with it.
Oh, yeah. No, it's cool. What about, did you see, how close were you to the puck that went out of the rink?
Are you talking about the one that broke the video screen?
Yeah, broke the video screen.
I wasn't there when it happened. I got there, okay. And Kyle Ireland's like, hey, did you see the puck hit? I'm like, I wasn't here for it. It legitimately, they have the in-arena banners that run around.
It like separates the upper and lower bowl.
And in the warm-up, somebody fired one very high.
Oh my gosh.
And it mashed into that and had the thing hanging out of its, like, where it's
because they didn't have nets set up around the ice.
Let's just put it there. There were three or four warnings to the fans. Just so you know, if you're sitting close enough to the ice, we have no nets up. So if sticks, pucks, or other objects fly into the crowd.
That's so funny.
It was a fun event.
Yeah. No, that's awesome. And it's great. Shout out to Ryan Smith and everybody with the organization for putting this on. And they're doing a really good job of just feeding the fire of the fan excitement right now. And I mean, we had the draft party and then this little scrimmage, and then I'm sure there's going to be another event or two before preseason even starts. And then everybody that went to the, what was that free event? Oh, the introduction.
Yeah, the
where if you
welcome
went early,
the team event.
Yeah, you could get the voucher to redeem preseason tickets. Mm-hmm. Like, there's so much stuff to get everybody in the community involved and everybody excited.
The interesting part will be as they move forward here is the in rink or in stadium environment, because I've got family that are from Southern California. They went to Ducks games, so the Anaheim Ducks, and their favorite thing that they're talking about, I love pounding on the glass. There's not going to be as many opportunities right now with the way that the arena is configured.
So you're saying there's not going to be a way really to get from your seats to right up against the glass?
There's going
to
be a few seats on both ends of the rink, but we're talking like, because you know, if you watch any of these hockey games, you got fans
right up against it. Yeah,
exactly. And they're pounding on the glass.
Yeah.
That's not going to be a very prevalent thing for at least the first few years here.
Until they renovate
it and figure out what they're going to do. But I still think that the in-arena experience is going to be awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Now, the obstructed seat views, I sat from two different vantage points in terms of like where the media sat yesterday, and both of them had blind spots.
Yeah.
So it's going to require you maybe looking at the screen once in a while to see what's going on in certain corners of the arena where you're sitting. But I think the bigger thing that's going to override all this is there's an excitement factor that is going to obviously take hold. It's already taken hold. The nice part is that we all know that excitement factor will fade away. The biggest thing that's going to keep fans coming is a winning team.
W is, baby.
And it feels like Bill Armstrong, I know Chris Armstrong is the team president, but Bill Armstrong, the GM, they've built this roster, at least based on what I've read slash heard, is they've got it set to compete. And that I think, is going to override everything else.
100%. And, I mean, there was the smoke screen with the draft where everybody was convinced that the hockey club was taking a defense.
Yeah, they're going to
at sixth overall. They're saying, oh, that's the biggest need. That's the biggest need. Mm-hmm. They take TJ Ginla, who's a center or a winger, depending on who you ask.
He said he wants to play center.
He wants to play center.
And
yeah,
based on how he played yesterday, yeah, leave him in the middle.
Yeah, leave him in the middle so he can be our first 50-point scorer. But regardless, they didn't take a defenseman. And yeah, then the next day, during the second round of the draft, they traded for Mikhail Sergachev.
Yes.
One of the bigger name.
And John Marino as well.
And John Marino, yep. Some pretty big name defensemen. So to me, those are like filling immediate needs, right?
They are, yeah.
So that's something, that's not something that a team will do if they don't plan on pushing for the playoffs, if that makes sense. They don't make that move unless they plan on at least trying to make the postseason. But at the same time, those players aren't old enough to where they're like, okay, they're only going to be here another year or two. They're young enough to be here as kind of cornerstones of that defensive, what do you call it, defensive, that blue line,
the
right?
Blue line group, yes.
Right, so I apologize. I'm learning this very quickly.
I literally went what blue line was earlier this week.
Yeah,
sound like I'm smart. I'm not that smart.
So, yeah, regardless, I mean, these are players that are going to be here for several years, shoring up a big need.
Yeah, and well, Sergachev's got 6 years remaining on an 8-year deal.
Oh, yeah, and he's great. He's great. We had a guy on from Tampa Bay, a beat writer on the Jake and Ben show earlier this week, telling us all about Mikhail Sergachev.
Eduardo Encina, right?
Encina, yep. And he was great. Made it sound like he's a great player, great dude off the ice. So that's awesome. That's exciting. And like I said, it filled a big need for this team. And then they've got, obviously, Clayton Keller on the offensive side. And then, you know, they're ready to make some noise this year and the next several years.
Well, and I think that if they do make the playoffs this year, even if they scrape in as one of the lower seeds, it's good enough.
Yeah.
Like, the biggest thing, we know this from years and years of covering Utah Jazz, the Utes, the Cougars in football, even their hoops programs. People here in Utah love a winner.
Right.
And they're loyal to a fault as well. Like, if you get a pretty good fan base, and I think they already have one with this hockey club, is that they're going to support this team through thick and thin. We're seeing that with the Utah Jazz right now.
Right. You just mentioned, I mean, the Jazz sold out almost every game this season,
They sold every single one. They're on a, I think, 2.5 year straight, like, every game
every
sold
game
out.
Sold out. And they're not good. They're not good.
They've pulled the plug twice in a row, and they're still selling it
out. So, like you say, loyal to a fault. But, no, and that's the nice thing is, I mean, I just mentioned that they made some great offseason additions, but the reality is there are no expectations for this team. And I mean, we could say maybe making the playoffs, but at the same time, like, I feel like people will understand if they don't make the playoffs. So I think that's really nice for this team to be able to make this transition. Everything going on, a lot of noise.
Yeah.
There's really no expectations for these guys yet.
The thing is, they get to set kind of the precedent of what they're doing as well. Because I know that this is the old Arizona Coyotes team. The roster-wise, they essentially took that roster, moved it to Salt Lake. It's an expansion franchise, folks.
No, we are not keeping any history with the Coyotes franchise. So, it's essentially an expansion team.
Can I insert that I would say that the Utah Coyotes has a really cool name to it, but that's
right.
That's
one of the coolest logos in sports.
Yeah, but
I'll go there too.
With what's his name, the owner, Alex Morello down there in Arizona, deciding to essentially stop trying to get a team back. That Coyotes name is up for grabs.
That would be so funny, having this whole offseason deal with the name voting, and then, actually, you know what? We'll just go Coyotes.
We're just going to go Coyote. Whatever. It is what it is. But, the bigger point is they have a chance to really kind of set the course of what this franchise is going to be here in the state of Utah, and they get to do it coming up in just over 2 months' time.
Oh, that's so cool. That's so exciting to think about. Yeah. Like a major franchise, and we get to sit here and watch the very beginning of it.
Yeah, October 8th. That's the official puck drop on the
regular
season. Chicago Blackhawks in town.
Yeah, big deal. Bedard, he's a good player.
Yeah.
One of the bigger names in the league.
That night, it's going to be absolutely electric.
Oh, dude, I can't wait. Yeah, we're going to be rocking. Oh, yeah, it's going to be so exciting.
Well, and the fun part of it is that you look at just the excitement level right now. As it gets closer and closer and as things start to really get ramped up, fans are just going to – it's going to be at an all-time just high once they actually drop the puck. Now, the preseason in and of itself is going to be exciting because they've got – I think there's three home games in that stretch. But I just think this is a team. There's an excitement factor that exists around it, and they're going to – the fans are going to show up simply out of curiosity's sake initially for some of them.
100%.
And if you can put a good product out there – guess what? People are going to come back.
I will say one thing that's interesting about the preseason is they only have one preseason game at the Delta Center.
Yeah, they had to...
They have one up in Des Moines.
Uh-huh.
They have one at the Delta Center, and then they have one at the Maverick Center. So yeah. Those are their three designated home preseason games.
Which is kind of funny. Des Moines, Iowa is your home.
Right,
but
yeah.
Neutral site. You know, the other thing about it is it's going to be an opportunity just to see how this squad comes together. There's a lot of stuff that you would think would carry over from the Coyotes, but none of it really does.
Yeah, as I mean, like you said, it's like the front office and the roster that carried over.
That's what they purchased.
It. Yeah.
They purchased the people, and Ryan talked about it. We've purchased people. I was talking to Jeffrey Sanders. They're a great PR guy. He's the head of...
Yeah, he's done a really good job so far.
I had a chance to finally, like, face-to-face get to meet him yesterday. He hasn't even moved to Utah yet.
No way. He's just here visiting.
Well, he's been. Well, let's put it this way. He's more than visiting. He's like taking up like a residence all of a sudden.
Yeah,
he's
like
been,
a 2 week. Oh, that's so funny.
But he's planning on getting up here, but he's not the only one.
Oh, like, yeah.
There's a lot of those that are having to relocate.
I mean, if you think about it, right, the rumors started popping up in March, if I'm remembering correctly. It was official in April.
Well, the Millers. The Smith Entertainment Group put out their statement in February saying, hey, we want an NHL franchise.
Yep.
The NHL responded, well, we don't really have a franchise available right now. And then the stuff with the Arizona Coyotes started to go down. And I think that's really, in March, you're right. The rumors started circulating like, hey, could Utah get a team as soon as the season?
It was like, oh my gosh, this might be a real thing.
And it happened.
So that's just putting into perspective of how quickly everything happened. So you're right. There are a lot of people that have not even moved up here. I know a lot of players kind of purchase homes pretty quickly.
Yeah.
So that was cool. But and some of the people are still getting hired. Like, we're talking about figuring things out behind the scenes. like you said, they're still filling out that PR staff.
Yes.
They're still filling out the communications side. So there's
well,
a
even
big,
the business, like,
oh yeah, the ticket sales, all that stuff. There's a large group of those employees for the organization that don't have a place yet here in Salt Lake City. So when we talk about having to do so much behind the scenes before the season starts, like, that's what we mean. And a lot of it goes unnoticed because we don't really see that. But it's just crazy how fast this has all happened. And shout out to everybody involved for working constantly, tirelessly, to make this happen before the season starts and have us ready.
Yeah, no doubt. It's going to be an exciting time. We'll see how it goes. All right, coming up next, we're going to flip over to American football. We're going to talk with Matt Brown. He's been on the station a lot. He writes the Extra Points newsletter, covers everything under the sun when it comes to college athletics. He's been one of the foremost voices on the new EA Sports college football franchise, the video game. We get some thoughts on the Big 12. We'll get to all that next as the Saturday show rolls on right here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone. Welcome back to the Saturday show here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone. Jay Catch here, Christian Esparza there. Big thank you to all of you for tuning in this morning. Joined now by Matt Brown. He is the publisher of Extra Points. He is just a jack of all trades when it comes to covering all things college athletics. Matt, thank you for carving out some time for us. How are you, sir?
I'm doing wonderful. Thanks for having me this morning.
Okay, I want to start here, Matt. How many questions are you expecting us to ask you about the EA Sports college football franchise?
I figure it's got to be at least one, right? I don't know at this point what else new I can say. I'll do my very best, but I don't think anyone's allowed to book me for any show for the next month without talking about it.
Probably true. Probably very true on that point. I wanted to ask you just in terms of how this has evolved, because there were the initial rumors that it was going to come out a year ago, then they delayed it a year, and you've been covering this the whole time. How exciting is it to think that all of your coverage of this is going to come to fruition when the game debuts here in less than 2 weeks?
you know, it's going to be a real relief. And it's ironic, right? I'm based in Chicago, but when the game's actually going to be released on the 19th, I'm going to be in your neck of the woods. I'm going to be in Utah on a vacation that I had planned months and months before the release date of this game was booked. You know, I've called DA and like, you guys, you know, did make this pretty inconvenient here for me. But I'm going to bring the PlayStation with me, but I think use that to make some friends at the family reunion on my wife's side that I'm going to. And it's going to be great, not just for me, because selfishly it means that my Twitter mentions are going to calm down a little bit. But this is like an emotional signpost for a lot of people who have been missing this thing for a decade. It's been a major story that's helped my publication grow and allowed me to spend money on reporting on other things. I've learned a lot about how the video game industry and the licensing industry and some of the kind of industrial complex of the sport works. I'm really excited to play it, and I hope it is. I hope it's worth the wait for not just fans, but the players in this game and the schools themselves.
Matt, speaking of complexities, and I'm sure this is a question you've probably answered already, but I went to Southern Utah University. We've got Weber State about 30 minutes north of here, another relevant FCS program. Do you know if they have any plans to introduce FCS schools in like a DLC or maybe future iterations of the game? What have you heard along that front?
Yeah, it's definitely been discussed for future iterations. I don't want to say it's impossible for a DLC in this release, but based on what I've been hearing, I think it's far more likely that those are teams that are added in later years of this franchise. And the reason that they're not in here for right now is there's a couple of different reasons, right? One of those, I am told, is because of concerns about the size and scope of the game itself. You add in FCS programs and those rosters and those stadiums and that iconography, you're nearly doubling the size of the game in terms of you know, space that's needed for rosters and for all that data, which is a tall order when you haven't released the thing in 3 years and you haven't stress tested every single one of these systems. And then there's the money component, because both EA and CLC has made it clear that you can't pay FBS schools and FBS athletes and then include FCS stuff and not pay them. Now, it might not be the same rate. I'm guessing Weber is not going to command as much in licensing fees as Utah is, or Utah Tech is probably going to be okay with a lower licensing payment for the athletes than BYU. But that still has to be taken care of. And I want to say that the total amount of money set aside for licensing between players, schools, bowls, the college football playoff, some of the music, I want to say the entire spend is in the neighborhood of $40 million. So I can understand why, you know, EA might have looked at that and said, you know, this might be a thing that we look at for 2027 rather than this year. There's going to be a couple of those things that were on the whiteboard originally, and then when push came to shove, they realized we can't squeeze everything we want to into this first game.
Now, with this game coming back, the college football universe is just going nuts about it. There are multiple Twitter accounts that have popped up talking about different things involved with it. You talk about the fact that it's going to be FBS schools, and now we have Utah and BYU in the Big 12 together. Is there going to be an ability with the ever-evolving landscape of college football in particular to move teams to new conferences if need be? Is that going to be an option in the game?
Very much so. The core game mode, for those that aren't familiar, there's a couple others, but the most popular one is Dynasty.
Yeah.
Where you're either a coach or a coordinator, and you're taking over a program and doing all the recruiting and trying to grow them. And before each season, you're allowed to create custom conferences. And if you decide to put BYU in the Big Ten or Utah in the SEC, you're going to see like the patches on their uniforms change and like the logos on the field change and everything. You can also change the scheduling rules for each year. So if you're in the Big 12 and you decide, I want to have a protected rivalry, so I want to make sure that the Holy War happens every year, I'm told you can do that. You want to change it, so no, we're only going to have 9 conference games, or we're going to have 10, or the championship game is going to be on campus rather than on a neutral site. You can tweak some of those things along with your custom schedule as you then build your program. So if you're a Utah fan and you want to live out the fantasy of Utah being in the Big 10 with this video game, you can do that.
Okay. Well, at least you can do it in the video game realm, right? That's the
sure. And for any you two are listening here, Cougar could then live out the fantasy of signing 5-star recruits.
Yes,
that's what the video games are for.
Let's Bingo. Hope that'll satiate the hunger of some local fans. Matt, I guess my last question before we get into talking about real football is, who's your dynasty team going to be? You know, your first run through.
It's a good question, right? Because I live in Chicago now, but I grew up outside of Columbus and I went to Ohio State. And to the extent that I care about any team emotionally, it's still that team. But I feel like it's cheating to set up a dynasty run with Ohio State, especially this year where they're going to have the best defense in the game out of the box, you know, a top four roster. I've never done that. You know, what I typically do is pick a one-star team, right, and try to build them up from there. I figure I'll probably start my first dynasty run with either Kent or Akron.
Okay.
You know, maybe Ohio. I'll kind of look at the rosters and see who's going to be easiest for an idiot like me to turn around. And the goal is to get that team competitive enough so I get the first bus out of town and go somewhere else. I imagine I will be joining much of the rest of the internet in spending some time at places like Kennesaw State and Sam Houston and some of these new schools as we work our way up to a powerhouse program.
I'm going to Hawaii to start. That's all I can tell you. Rainbow Warriors is what I'm rolling
with.
Oh,
that's awesome.
Sure.
Right, I might have to go Utah State.
Yeah, something like that. That's the fun part about it. Now, talking about the Big 12 here, we have Utah being tabbed as the favorite. Now, they're a slight favorite with Kansas State, just one first-place vote behind them. Give me your sense, Matt, looking at the Big 12 this season, how likely it is Utah is going to be able to come out on top.
I mean, if I had a vote, and it's a good thing that I don't because I'm on a beat writer in this market, but if I did, that's probably how I would vote. Utah 1, Kansas State 2. I think an exciting thing about the league this year and maybe a frustrating one as far as college football playoff seeding or, you know, a bit is concerned is I don't really think there's a huge difference in this conference between number 1 and number 6. If you wanted to passionately make an argument for Arizona, potentially for Kansas, maybe even Oklahoma State, I don't think that the gap is super wide. Like any one of those teams, I think, could win the league, and it wouldn't be totally shocking. There's probably 4 teams in the league that I think don't have a shot at competing for anything meaningful in the conference this year. And then from there, though, almost anybody else could win the league. Utah is the most complete roster, and I think that they are built in a way that's going to make them extremely uncomfortable to play for many of the other teams in this league. But you know, there's not a team full of 5-stars, but there's a bunch of teams that are experienced and talented and will make for, I think, a lot of competitive games this season.
Matt, this kind of does tie into the video game conversation, but what are your thoughts on Colorado? I know there was a lot of controversy on their overall rating, but I guess in the video game and in real life, too, what are your thoughts on the Buffs?
Yeah, we'll do the video game first, and then we can talk about the real life team, right? In the video game, if you are somebody that has healthy emotional boundaries and has like not been on Twitter as often as maybe we have, Colorado is ranked as a top 25 roster in the video game. I want to say they're like an 87 overall, tied with another dozen or so teams. And I don't agree with that rating, obviously, but I think I understand how it happens because I believe these ratings are going to be skewed a little bit towards stars, and Colorado's going to have 3 or 4 elite players at their positions. And they're also based in large part on PFF ratings. And my hunch here is that launch, it's a little bit harder for EA to properly rate some of these new transfers, people that might have had high PFF ratings at smaller schools or in different settings. And so maybe they're artificially high, which is why you see a team that was, top bottom 25 in yards per play on defense, suddenly having a top 25 grade. I'm on the field in real life. I am almost coming around to the idea that they might even be underrated. I don't think this is a team that's likely to really win the league or anything. But I wonder if maybe the social media backlash to Deion, who is very easy to feel strongly about, has swung the other way a little bit. It's a team that I think has some of the similar problems as last year. I don't really see a world where this is a plus offensive line. You're bringing another gajillion transfers, and continuity is so important along the line of scrimmage. I do think their pass rush is going to be better. I do think that their depth is a little bit better. And if you have a plus quarterback, and you have a plus defensive back, and you have plus special teams, and you're not going against Oregon this year, you're not going against the USC, I think that they could be in if they're healthy. They should be in most of their games. I don't think this is a team that finishes under 500.
Interesting. So they would. You think they go bowling at least this fall?
Yeah, I definitely think they'll go bowling. You can look at this and think, boy, this is you got questions at linebacker, you got questions at offensive line, and if they get unlucky with injuries, then you see how you go 4-8 and kind of give up like they did last year. But you can paint over a lot of roster deficiencies if you have three dudes.
Sure.
And Colorado has more than three dudes.
Now, I want to ask you, so BYU picked 13th out of 16 teams in the Big 12. I think any Cougar fan listening to this understands it was going to be a process as BYU made the transition to now was the Power 4 level in terms of competing at the top of the conference. Where do you feel year two the Cougars are at right now?
I think 13th about right. I think that the goal for this team, right, is you want to scratch and claw for a bowl bid. You want to try to upset at least one of the top five teams in this league, and you want to be able to build continuity and an identity for next year. Arizona State and Houston should be like capital B bad, I think, and BYU should be in front of them. But it's hard for me to kind of see the argument for why they would finish much better, unless you're betting that this offense comes together and has become substantially more prolific than any of the individual component parts or returning production would have you believe. And that, I think, is kind of the question mark I have, not just for this team this year, but moving forward. What kind of football do they really want to play, I think? And maybe this is a problem for me because I haven't watched them as extensively as you guys. I don't know if their exact identity for what they want to do on offense is as clear to me. I don't, obviously you don't want to be a team that's going to try to run 110 plays a game anymore. But given the athletes that you have, that you can get, and the caliber of people that you can get and retain in the transfer portal relative to the rest of this league, how are you planning on making up some of those depth deficiencies? They could get there in a couple of years, but I don't think this isn't the kind of place where you can just take 45 transfers. I think it's the kind of, this has always been the kind of school where if you don't have a top 15 quarterback, I don't know how the pathway for you to win more than 8 games. I definitely don't think that they have that this year. And I can't remember the last time, BYU's been able to win with just kind of average quarterback play and like win at a higher level, just by beating people up. I don't think you can get the guys to do that in this league right now.
So looking at the media preseason poll, we had Utah, Kansas State, and Oklahoma State by far getting the most votes to finish first overall. Matt, if you had to pick a dark horse outside of those top three teams to win this conference, who would it be?
I want to say Iowa State's returning almost everybody, right?
They're returning a lot, yes.
They're returning a lot. I want to say that they've been a little bit unlucky in both close games and with injuries the past couple of seasons. I love their coaching staff. I'd have to go look and check what the home and away splits are, but I think Iowa State would be in that conversation. Kansas got first place votes, right? So I don't think that they're an exact sleeper. But yeah, I think we can make compelling arguments for Arizona, for Kansas, or for Iowa State, I think. But at least getting to the conference championship game, and you're not going to sound ridiculous in July.
Kansas, 5 first place votes. Arizona, 3 first place votes. Iowa State, the only team you mentioned, doesn't have a first place vote, so they would fit the dark horse narrative there, Matt.
Yeah, there you go.
Now, before we let you go, I just want to ask you nationally. You talk about Ohio State, where they look like they're poised to do something big this year. I know you went to Ohio State. Why do so many people want seemingly to bag Ryan Day, it feels like, on any given day?
There's good reasons for that, right? Like here's the thing about Ohio State. I think outside of the Big Ten footprint, you look at the expectations of this program and think, these people are insane. The Ohio State's won every game except for the playoff game and except for against Michigan, essentially. They've mostly won comfortably. They're recruiting at an elite level. What's the problem? Well, the problem is Ohio State is probably the most recession-proof college football program in the country. You have to go back to like the 50s before they were bad for any extended stretch. They've really only been outside of championship contention maybe 3 years in my entire life. Given the financial resources they have, given their dominance in the state of Ohio, which is still an important, although declining, producer of prep talent, and the fact that they're going to be overwhelmingly, or you know, have been overwhelmingly better than everyone else in the Big Ten talent-wise, other than some years Michigan, some years Penn State, the expectation is if you're an average coach, you're going to win 10 games there, and that's where it's been really since the tail end of the BCS era. Ohio State's stated goals are, we want to beat Michigan, we want to win the Big Ten, we want to compete for a national championship. They haven't done that the past couple of years under Ryan Day. And the way that they haven't done it, by being physically dominated at the line of scrimmage by Michigan, who is running an offense that is the spiritual goal, like the platonic ideal of what a certain kind of Ohioan thinks Ohio State should be like. You know, Woody Hayes didn't die. He just ascended into the subconscious of everyone in the state. Like, that breaks people's brains. And Ryan Day is not from Ohio. He's not a longtime college football coach. And the word out on him is that he's too nice and normal of a human being to properly be the kind of dirtbag that is necessary to win at the elite levels of college football. Ryan Day has read a book in the last 6 months. He's seen a movie in a movie theater. Like, these are things that, like, I don't think Kirby Smart's read a book other than maybe something he explicitly thought would help him in recruiting for a while. And that's not because he's dumb. It's just because he's so completely singular-minded. So, yeah, Ohio State has spent a lot of money this year to go build this roster. They're spending a lot of money in high school recruiting. They're spending a lot of money on this coaching staff. And they're putting in all of their chips for this season. And if they lose to Michigan, who should be probably not a college football playoff team this year, given who they lost, if they lose to Oregon, if they're non-competitive, there's going to be an enormous push for Ryan Day to go take an NFL job. And I know that sounds crazy, but, you know, when those are the expectations at that program, that's what people are, you know, that's why people are giving you all that money for the roster.
Well, you can find Matt at the Extra Points newsletter. Matt, I know you know I've been subscribed to it since the day you launched it. It's an incredible product. If you want the kind of the minutia of college athletics, I think is what you – is that the term you use, is minutia? Is that the
– Yeah, minutia. What I really cover the most, folks, is the off-the-field stuff that shapes the industry. So, next week I've got a story about how athletic departments are engaging with Latino and Spanish-speaking fans.
Okay.
I've got stories coming out here about Olympic sports management, about basketball scheduling, about recruiting, about the video game, conference realignment, all of that kind of stuff. If you're into it, you can find it at extrapointsmb.com.
It's fascinating. Matt, thank you for carving out some time for us. We'll catch up with you again soon, all right?
Of course, fellas. Thanks for having me. Be well.
There you go. Matt Brown from the Extra Points newsletter. And I've literally subscribed since the day you launched it.
Yeah, I mean, saw him, of course, with all this EA college football news, and I've been following him, his work.
His mentions, by the way, if you ever go look at his mentions, it's awesome.
Yes, no, it's crazy, and I know that he's gained thousands and thousands of followers because of this college football game and his coverage of that, and he's done an excellent job, so he definitely deserves that, and he's really been a great source for a lot of good information that people are dying to know because this is such a big cultural thing.
I bought the whole package so I can get the early access. I'm going to be playing July 16th. I'll just tell you that much.
There you go.
I'm that much of a sycophant when it comes to this game. So looking forward to it. All right, coming up on the other side, we're going to get to technical fouls. We'll talk about some of the other things in sports. I got some doozies out there I found this morning, Christian. We'll get to all that next right here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone.
If you're coming from the street with dirty shoes on your feet, that's a technical foul. If you switch the radio to some modern music show, that's a technical foul. If you touch the thermostat,
you'll get hit with a bat.
Cause that's a technical foul.
You won't feel my wrath.
That's a technical foul.
Personal foul, 69, offense. He was giving them the business.
A technical foul.
Welcome back to the Saturday Show. You heard it's time now for technical fouls, talking about some of the more frivolous or dumb things in sports as it is. We like to have some fun with that. Okay, I'm going to start off with this, Christian. What kind of fine would you be willing to impose if you were an athlete to, you know, be able to plant one on your wife during said sporting event?
Like, how much would I be willing to pay?
Like a fine.
Well, if we're talking like, you know, a star that makes millions, probably a cool like 10-15K, I guess.
Okay, you're willing to spend a lot more than most people, I think. French writer Julian Bernard was fined 2,000 Swiss francs, which is about $223 American dollars, by the International Cycling Union after he stopped to kiss his wife during his time trial seventh stage of the Tour de France.
He stopped to kiss his wife. Got fined?
Yeah, so he is from, his home region is Burgundy, there in France. He paused to kiss his wife and young son who were standing on the road among a group of family and friends. The UCI, which is the governing body, said in a statement that Bernard's behavior had been inappropriate and damaged the image of the sport.
That's crazy. That makes no sense to me because it's a race. So you would think that...
He's like costing himself time,
right,
guys.
Him costing himself time by pausing to give his wife a kiss.
Yeah, like, come on now.
Yeah, that's crazy. At least, I mean, $223 isn't insane. I mean, it's ridiculous that he is getting fined for that, but at least they didn't fine him thousands.
And I like this guy's response on social media. Quote, "I'm sorry, UCI, for damaging the image of the sport, but I'm willing to pay 200 Swiss francs every day and experience this moment again," unquote.
Good husband.
So, $200, $223. That's what it costs, apparently.
Did he win? How did he finish?
See, I don't even know. I didn't even see if it ended up showing. I didn't see a time on this, so I don't know. So there you go. Kind of funny.
That is funny.
So, yeah, there you go. All right, what else you got?
I'll go with Bronny James. Okay. We like to hate on LeBron here.
We don't like to hate on LeBron. He brings it upon himself.
LeCap is one of his alter egos. He likes to lie, and it seems like it runs in his genes. Bronny's out here telling lies, too. He said in his post-draft media availability, they, of course, asked him about playing with his dad. He said, "I never really had a thought of me going to play with my dad, but that's always there to take part of, but it wasn't a main focus of mine."
Okay.
You've never thought about playing with your dad, and that's been his lifelong dream.
Your dad has said it on the record for years.
Years and years ago.
Literally years. "I'm going to play in the NBA until I can play with my son in the NBA." Here it is. Don't say you didn't think about it.
You know what's funny, though? Not only does he lie just like LeBron and tell these little fibs, he actually sounds just like him. So it is kind of funny hearing him talk because he literally sounds like a carbon copy of LeBron James. So that part's kind of funny.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Come on now. Like, I feel like sometimes there are certain athletes out there that like think that they're so much smarter than the rest of the people in the world.
Yeah.
And this, I never thought about playing with my dad, Bronny.
Right.
Your dad talks about it all the time.
You think from a PR standpoint, like, what does that do? Like, I get that you're trying to be like play the humble card or whatever.
I'm my own man.
Right.
You're playing for the Los Angeles Lakers because your dad got this literally put into motion to get you there.
And I guess that's the tough part about this situation is just it's a mess. And, I mean, it's going to be the main storyline going forward for Bronny and LeBron and the Lakers. And I feel bad for the kid, to be honest with you, because he didn't ask for this.
Yeah, no doubt. Also, real quick, last night, I saw this on social media. Have you guys ever been to a baseball game where the team likes to shoot off fireworks and never have them run out of fireworks?
Run out?
Yes, run out. Quite literally run out.
No.
So the Pittsburgh Pirates smashed the New York Mets last night, 14-2. They hit 7 home runs as a team. The team said it ran out of fireworks.
Because they hit so many home runs.
Hit 7 in the game.
Wow.
2 grand slams. Brian Reynolds and Rowdy Tellez became the first teammates in Major League history to each hit multiple homers, including a grand slam in the same game. It's absolutely nuts. Now, Reynolds is rolling right now. He's got a 25-game hitting streak that started back in June.
You said this was yesterday?
Last night.
They used their fireworks budget on the 4th and they were just shooting off the scraps yesterday.
Maybe so. But they did say, they said this. This is their tweet. "We hit so many home runs, we ran out of fireworks. We're being serious."
That's so funny.
Yeah. But
that's cool.
So there
good
you go.
For the fans.
You run out of fireworks, apparently. You can do that. All right. So there you go. Anything else you got for us?
No. Okay. No, I think that's it.
All right. Well, we will come back on the other side. I want to dig more into the Big 12 media poll and also the Big 12 all-conference preseason team.
Yeah.
And we'll get into those next. We continue on right here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone. Literally being here finally. I've taken the ice yesterday for the first time in terms of anybody representing the club, because it's not the NHL players per se, but they are the prospects. They also talked with Matt Brown about EA Sports College Football 25. I seriously am probably going to start my dynasty mode with Hawaii.
Oh, that's so funny. I am. I'll probably do Utah State, like I said. Maybe I'll play around with another school. But real quick before we move on, okay, how did the jerseys look on the ice yesterday?
I don't know if those are the final jerseys. They look good, though. White and black were the main colors.
That was one of my biggest questions, if those were going to be the jerseys that they're going to be wearing.
It looks similar. Now, they did the jerseys they were wearing at the draft with the Utah and the diagonal, that is what I understand is going to be the actual NHL jersey. Yesterday, it was kind of the circle logo with that Utah hockey.
Okay.
So that wasn't, but the look looked great.
Good.
Now, the merchandise sales, they were going, it was a hot item yesterday.
Yeah. If you want any Utah Hockey Club merch, you better set aside about 2 hours to wait in line from what it sounds like.
There were a lot of people there, yes. I walked by it just to go see what it was looking like, and it was brisk business, as they say.
Yes, for sure.
And people were dropping some coin. All right, so I want to get back to the Big 12 conversation here for a minute, Christian. The Big 12 actually, I think, played this the right way. They announced the Big 12 preseason media poll before the July 4th holiday, because had you announced it like, yesterday on the 5th or on Monday, it's just kind of that post-holiday malaise, I like to call it. Where you kind of, it might have been swallowed up, it feels like. So I think they got ahead of it and actually got some extra, I don't know, attention out of it, if that makes sense. So looking at it, it's the first time this conference is going to have 16 teams. The Utes, speaking of University of Utah, have been picked as the preseason Big 12 favorite. They do have one first-place vote extra over Kansas State, who was in second. You mentioned it with Matt Brown, who we had on earlier, that Oklahoma State is in third. Let's start off with Utah. They're, I think both of us are in agreement. We're not surprised that they're the favorite. Are you surprised that they were as narrow a favorite as they were, though?
No, I'm not surprised. I think they've got some genuine questions, and it's always tough when with Cam Rising. We didn't see him play for a whole season. There are legitimate questions about the health of his knee. He's never played a full season in any year. He's always had some sort of injury holding him back. But we have seen that when he plays, he's great, and he leads this team to great things. So that's definitely what they have going for them. But you can't win if your quarterback's not healthy. So I think that's a valid concern for the Utes. And then the rest of their offense, I mean, Brant Keithy, same thing, missed all of last season with a similar injury. And so, yeah, theoretically, they have all the pieces they need to be a really good team, but we all know that sports never go how they should on paper, right?
Sure, yeah.
So, yeah, I think health is a genuine concern for the Utah offense, but, man, I'll tell you what, their defense should be the best defense in this league. I'm actually, by the way, I'm looking at like the preseason teams, and Utah only has two players on the Big 12 all defensive team. That's Junior Tafuna on the defensive line. And then, I guess only one player on the defense, their punter, Jack Bomeister, made the team, but only one defensive player made it from Utah. I'm really shocked that Lander Barton's not on there.
Here's the thing, 16 teams makes it really tough.
There is a lot of talent, and maybe I'm way higher on Lander Barton national media is.
No, Lander Barton deserves to be on this team.
Yeah.
The problem is you only did one team.
Right.
Now, if you do a second team,
maybe third team.
Third team seems a bit much. Now, if you read Phil Steele, Lander Barton's feature prime, there's a lot of Utah guys. He goes four teams deep.
Yeah.
Like, and props to you, Phil. Like
he's great. He's a psycho. He does...
Psycho's a good term for
that. It's really hard to do what Phil Steele does, but
yes,
Lander Barton. Spoiler alert for the Hands and Scotty 1660. I mean, I had Lander Barton extremely high in my ballot.
Did you have him number one?
I didn't have him number one.
Okay,
I had him very high though.
He's in my top 10.
I had him top five.
No, he's in my top five too. Yeah, I was just saying my list. I'm like, no, yeah, he's in my top five as well.
But regardless, the Utes have some dogs on their defense all around, not just Lander Barton. I mean, Tao Johnson is supposed to take a huge leap forward. They've got other good linebackers, defensive linemen all around. I know Coach Whittingham is really high on all of their defensive backs. And, I mean, defense is what Utah kind of always does great, right?
Yes.
So I really genuinely think that the Utes are going to have the best defense in this conference.
See, and the thing about it is, as you look at the linebackers that were on that list, Jacob Manu from Arizona, very, very good player. The interesting part was Nick Martin and Colin Oliver from Oklahoma State taking up two of those spots.
Yeah.
which if you look at their stats, both of them prolific. Same with Manu.
Yeah.
But the fact that Oklahoma State, which is considered by most people, in most people's eyes, they're more no more for their offense under Mike Gundy than their defense. I was interested to see that two Cowboys got the linebacker nods there, and like a guy like Lander Barton got passed over, it looks like.
Yeah, but going back to Utah and the narrow finish for first place, I mean, what are your thoughts on those?
Here's the thing. Utah, in my mind, was always going to be the favorite. I did wonder whether Oklahoma State, who made the Big 12 title game a year ago, they did play in it, or Kansas State Wildcats, how close they would get to them.
Yeah.
I'm actually surprised that Kansas State was just one first place vote back. I thought that Utah would have a pretty healthy margin.
Yeah, that's insanely close.
And I don't know the machinations of the media poll because, trust me, I know how many media vote on this. I had an opportunity to vote on it. And I think that there is maybe a little bit of a dichotomy of some of the newcomers to the conference media-wise who were promoting Utah and the teams coming in, and the old guard, as we'll call them,
right?
Maybe stumping for Kansas State, which, by the way, Chris Kleiman has done an incredible job.
Yeah.
They got a five-star prospect out of their own home state this week, speaking of Kansas State, a tight end. He had offers to go all over the country, and they kept him home in Manhattan, Kansas.
No, that's great, and that's definitely a good point about kind of the, you know, you had these teams that are staying in the Big 12 after some of the bigger programs left, and then they've got newcomers coming in like Utah and Arizona, and it maybe there is some sort of jealousy factor, I guess, what you could call it, is that Utah is getting all this attention. Arizona was getting all this attention before they lost their head coach.
Mm-hmm.
So, maybe there is some sort of changing of the guards mentality of where they don't want to really pass that title over yet and give the respect where it's due. But again, at the same time, I could see it because Utah hasn't done anything in the conference yet.
Yeah, but this conference lost its two big dogs. And,
right.
You know, I cover this conference pretty extensively with what I do here at the station and also just with my podcast and everything. When you lose Texas and Oklahoma, it leaves a vacuum at the top of the league.
There's no identity for this conference right now.
And that's kind of the fun part for this conference.
Yes.
They get to kind of establish their own identity with
right.
a whole cavalcade. They've had 8 new teams join this conference in the last 2 seasons.
We talked in the first segment about the Utah Hockey Club coming here and establishing their kind of new identity and new history and stuff like that. It's kind of a similar thing with the Big 12 conferences. They have had all these new teams, 8 of the 16 teams in the conference are new within the last 2 seasons. So there is a lot of new history to be made within these next couple of seasons, especially with all the other realignment that's gone on in college football. So, yeah, it's going to be exciting how things shake out over the next season or two.
So looking at it, I'm not surprised that Utah's the favorite. I think if it's okay, I say this by adding the caveat that Utah's got to stay healthy. Remember, the injury bug that they endured last year.
It was one of the worst we've ever seen, ever,
insane.
In any sport.
I still am baffled at how many guys went down last year.
No, I remember going to Whittingham's Monday press conferences, and he was literally speechless. He had, what can you say at that point when every week you're losing multiple starters?
Well, there's not much to say at that point, but the thing is, should they stay healthy, and that's the caveat you have to add to this, there's really anything that Utah isn't the favorite here in the league.
Yeah.
And the other thing about it is there are some people out there that believe that Utah doesn't know what they're in for, that the Big 12 is going to be a different field than the Pac-12. Here's the deal. I have watched Kyle Whittingham's programs for 2 decades now, at minimum, both as a fan, also as a media member. And the one thing I can say is that we had Matt Brown, and he talked about Ohio State being recession-proof as a football program. If there is a program that I feel like the style of play, the way the program is constructed, they can go into, I feel like, almost any league out there and just kind of do their thing, it's Kyle Whittingham's Utah program.
Yeah, and you just look at the team and the way they play, and that's kind of, it's their philosophy, right? They are a very defensive-minded program. They want to control the clock, control the game,
yes.
and then do what they need to do on offense in order to win. But they put the emphasis on their defense, and you're right, that's exactly how Kyle Whittingham's philosophy is, and it's worked for many, many years, and it led to great success in the recent years in the end of the Pac-12, and they were in it up until the very end last year, in spite of all the injuries that they had.
Yes, and that's the funny thing about this, is it showed you how deep this program was last year. Truthfully, you watched, they were still competing, and when you absorb as many injuries as Utah absorbed, very few programs would be able to hold the standard that they play to as much as they did.
Yeah.
Eventually, you come to a point where it's not going to hold up. And that's what happened at the tail end of last year for Utah. It ran out of gas. But I look at it, I'm not surprised they're the favorite. They should be, and I'm looking forward to seeing what Kyle Whittingham and the players going down to Big 12 Media Day have to say about that. I am fully expecting a whole bunch of no comment.
Yeah.
Because that's not Kyle Whittingham's style to go out there and talk about like being the favorite. Could he change my mind? Yeah, he could.
Yeah, they're going to come out and say, oh, yeah, we're just excited to get to work.
We're focused on game by game.
Yep, game by game.
One game season.
Doesn't matter. We'll do what we need to do week in, week out.
Now, the other thing about it is, looking at it, I'm not surprised that Kansas State and Oklahoma State are right there behind them. I'm actually pleasantly surprised that we saw Kansas as well getting some just due with Jalen Daniels under center for the Jayhawks. Not surprised they got some votes. And then Arizona, even with all the coaching turnover, having Jed Fish leave for Washington and all the turnover they had, they're still getting a measure of respect by getting 3 first-place votes for the Wildcats as well.
Yeah, they've got a roster. They've got a lot of talent, like you said. And that, like I mentioned earlier, before Jed Fish left, they were a team. It was basically Utah or Arizona that people were pegging as the favorites. So obviously losing your head coach is huge.
Yeah.
But it's not a death penalty, especially when your roster is as good as theirs.
Well, and I look forward to this because that means it's going to be some depth to this league, and we'll see how it all goes. Matt Brown mentioned things that Iowa State could be a dark horse. I would agree. They have a bunch of guys coming back from Matt Campbell, and he's had his back against the wall for a little bit here. Let's see if they can respond. But the fun part about this league is it's going to be a little bit dog-eat-dog out there.
Yeah, it's a lot of parity. I think it's a very, very even league across the board. Even BYU last year, their overall record wasn't as great as they hoped, but they were in it. They were in most of their games, and that's in spite of their quarterback play being subpar, and obviously that led to them being picked at 13 right now.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they're going to have the chance to be in most of their games again this year, and I think even though they're picked 13, I don't think they're going to finish that low.
I can tell you that people in Provo, they like where they're picked.
Right.
And they like where they picked because when you have low expectations, guess what? Overachieving is much easier.
Yes.
When you're Utah and you're the favorite, there's nowhere higher to go.
Right. And if you don't meet expectations, that's when you look bad.
Sure.
Hard to finish lower than 13th in the conference.
The thing about BYU is they learned some very hard lessons last year.
Yeah.
They started 5-2. And trust me, all of us, and I do the pre and post game shows with Alex Carey, and we sat there through that kind of 5-2 start thinking, they are scraping by in certain ways on this. But then the wheels kind of came off. Injuries caught up with them. They lost 5 straight games to end the season. Very competitive against Oklahoma State to end the season, which would have gotten them to a bowl game. And the fact that they missed out on a bowl game, had that 5-game losing streak coming into this year, it's not sitting right in Provo at all.
And that's tough to end. Not only do you end the season on a bad note, but then you've got this bad taste in your mouth all off season. Then these preseason polls come out. You're picked 13th out of 16. So, of course, that's going to be some extra motivation for Kalani Sitake and his crew. They've got some talented players. Chase Roberts, everybody's expecting big things out of him. They're running back field. We'll see what happens there. And then especially under center, we'll see. We don't even know who they're going to trot out day one. But it's going to be fun.
My money currently is still sitting on Jake Gretzloff being the guy.
Yeah, I mean, incumbent starter, right? He closed out the season last year. So I feel that's the safest bet. But that's the thing is they've got basically 3 different dudes that they could throw out there. And you tell yourself, yeah, I'm not surprised.
But the other thing about it is with the Cougars, they have a lot of unknowns. There's no doubt about that. It's just you look at what they're doing. But the other thing is they learned some very hard lessons last year about what it's going to take to compete at this level. I'm not saying that BYU is going to go up and jump up in the top 4 of the league this year. That'd be, I think, a big stretch. But I think if what I said, talking to people in Provo, they accomplish what they believe they can accomplish. I think middle of the table, so jumping up to where you're 6-6, 7-5, it's not out of the realm of possibility for BYU.
No, not at all. And that's something that Kalani Sitake touched on in his end-of-season presser. It's hard going from being independent to the P5, now P4 level, as far as everything off the field, you know, what your strength and conditioning programs looked like, and the players definitely felt that towards the tail end of that season. So Satake mentioned, like, yeah, now these players know what the expectations are as far as how to take care of their bodies, how to prep their bodies mm-hmm. for the season, because it is a more physical level of play than what they were used to at the independent level. It is a big jump in athleticism and strength and conditioning.
Yes.
So now the players recognize that. And, I mean, it is hard to tell a kid, like, hey, you've got to put in this work in the off season. The best way for them to learn is to kind of go through that and see this is why you need to put in this work in the off season, because it's a different beast.
And the conversations I've had with BYU players point exactly to that.
Right.
You can talk and talk and talk about, okay, we're jumping up a level, guys. It's hyper-competitive. It's nothing you've ever experienced before. I can tell you that there were certain players inside the BYU football program who they had played a pretty decent schedule as an independent, especially the last 3 or 4 years
yes.
leading up to joining the Big 12. There was one season where they played 7 Power 5 opponents in that 1 year, then when they went 5-0 against the Pac-12. So more than half of their opponents were Power 5-level teams. And I think that may have given, in some guys' eyes, we can hang with those guys. The problem is when you play this level of football, there's no cycling for it. With 7 Power 5 teams, there are 5 other teams that weren't Power 5. So you could play a game where you could put a B-plus product out on the field and still win said game.
Yes.
I think what the players themselves learned last year is this is a gauntlet.
Yeah.
You start the season... Okay, you ramp up a little bit. You play an FCS team, maybe a G5 team, and you play another Power 5 team. That's kind of and that's what you cycle up for. And then it's 9 games.
Once that conference schedule starts, it's game over. Like it's a gauntlet, like you said, and it's tough. And going from not having that as an independent school to
sure.
having that last year for the first time in their first year as a Big 12, it's a huge change.
Now they learn those lessons, and they'll be better for it. The issue I still believe that BYU is facing is having the adequate depth to absorb the hits that will inevitably come.
Oh, yeah.
Remember what happened with Ben Bywater. Me and PK were out in Kansas when BYU played their first Big 12 road game out there in Lawrence against the Jayhawks. Ben Bywater goes trotting off the field with his shoulder like dangling from his body. Never came back that season. BYU's defense was never the same without him in the middle of it, really kind of being the captain, the guy directing traffic in there. They've recruited to get to that level. They're trying to get where they can have a guy like a Bywater who you never want to see guys go down due to injury, but if an injury were to hit, they hope that at some point they would have the depth they can step in and hold the standard they were playing to. They've done a better job this year about building that up. It's going to be a multi-year effort to get to that level. I say this often on this show. Utah has a 12-year head start on BYU.
Yeah. No, those are the two biggest differences. Between the P4 level and the rest of college football,
yeah,
strength and conditioning and depth.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody has top-end talent. Matt Brown was talking about Colorado. They've got dudes, right?
Yeah.
But what separates, you know, the best teams from the average teams from the bad teams
correct.
Is how deep they are throughout the roster to be able to sustain these injuries that everybody inevitably suffers throughout the season. So, yeah, BYU, similar to Utah, they suffered a lot of injuries last year. Utah, like we said, they were able to scrape by and they did fall apart at the end of the season, but they were able to be competitive until the very end because, like you said, they've got this 12-year head start.
Yeah.
BYU now, again, they've got this experience. They know what to expect. They went out. They did a lot of recruiting,
mm-hmm.
and hopefully they shored up their depth.
We'll see. I'm excited for it. The thing about this is the season's coming fast.
Oh, so fast.
And the best part is BYU and Utah are in the same league again. So it's going to be interesting to kind of track both teams, how they navigate the Big 12 seasons upcoming, how they both compete, obviously, with Utah's the favorite. BYU's near the bottom. And there's two different expectation levels for where they're at in that preseason poll. I'm excited to hear them talk at Big 12 Media Day, by the way, if you're wanting wall-to-wall coverage of that. Right here, The Zone. We've got all of our
literally
staff
literally all day Tuesday and Wednesday.
Yeah.
That's all we're going to be doing here.
So if you're looking for hoops talk that day,
yeah,
might be a little bit light on the hoops talk.
Hopefully Lowry doesn't get traded on either of those days.
You know that's going to happen, right?
Yeah.
That's always how it goes.
Right, so we'll see. Of course.
We'll see how it goes. All right, we will come back on the other side. We'll get into 5 minutes of, talk about some of the other topics we've not had a chance to touch on quite yet in today's show. It's all coming up next right here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone.
Welcome back to the Saturday Show here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone. Jake Hatch, Christian Esparza, breaking things down on a Saturday morning. Thanks for tuning in. Hope you all are doing well out there. All right, time for 5 minutes of covering some of the other topics we have not had a chance to touch on quite yet on today's show. We have trades going on in the NBA. It's still, you know, NBA free agency season, Christian.
Yeah, it's been really quiet, and of course, free agency is kind of dying in the NBA. Every year there seems to be less and less big names that make it to free agency. But yeah, trades are always fun, even when they're players that don't affect the league, really.
Well, so the San Antonio Spurs are trading guard Devontae Graham and a second-round pick to the Charlotte Hornets. So the Hornets are going to waive Graham, making him a free agent. That's kind of the news we've already reached in free agency, which, remember, we're not even talking like 5 years ago. It felt like it was a week solid of just news.
Yep. I mean, NFL's free agency kills it
every
year. Even same thing, even if stars necessarily don't make it. But I feel like there's definitely enough depth players in the NFL to make free agency interesting. Of course, the rosters are much deeper, 53 guys versus like 15 in the NBA rosters. But yeah, free agency just was not that exciting this year for the NBA. I mean, everybody kind of knew what was going to happen. Everyone knew that LeBron was going to re-sign with the Lakers after he waived his player option. Everybody knew Paul George was going to leave the Clippers, and the 76ers were the favorites to land him. So, yeah.
It was kind of funny to hear Steve Cleveland on the Jazz draft broadcast. I don't know if you heard this. He was like, well, essentially, he bet PK and Jake and Ben, I'll buy you guys dinner if he goes
to
Philadelphia.
I'll get you guys a steak dinner if he leaves Los Angeles.
Yeah,
he doesn't seem like he's from Los Angeles. He's not going to leave there. I'll take you guys out to a steak dinner if he leaves LA. And everybody was like,
okay.
They were like, are you sure you want to make that bet, Steve? And then,
by the way, came on last Monday with DJ and PK and said he's willing to pay up.
Oh, that's so funny.
So
Steve's a good guy.
Steve is a stud, by the way. He's been incredible to our station. Obviously, he's been a weekly guest throughout the hoop season. I think it almost goes year-round at this point with how often he joins DJ and PK. But really cool to hear him talk about that. Now, the other thing is, in the NBA, is we're looking at a season upcoming that I'm interested to see how teams are going to reinvent themselves is probably the best term to use. I'm thinking of Golden State, for example.
Yeah.
Klay Thompson leaves. So one of the Splash Brothers, the era of the Splash Brothers is over. Now, it's kind of been over for...
It's been over for a while, since 2022.
But he is leaving Golden State. He's going to Dallas, so you wish him the best as he goes and joins up with Luka and Kyrie and see how he does there. But Golden State, they're trying to kind of reinvent themselves. Steph Curry is still playing at an elite level.
Yeah.
Now, how long that's going to last is now he's in his 30s. That's TBD. But there are obviously rumors involving the Utah Jazz and Lauri Markkanen being on the market. And Golden State, I had two conversations with two people in the Bay Area this week when I was reaching out for guests to come on with DJ and PK who were saying that there's real legs to this.
Yeah, why wouldn't they be interested, right? Now, like, he's a great player.
And he would allow them to extend their, I don't know, you want to call it a contender window, whatever you want to call it. It would allow him to extend that window because he is young enough that he extends that window for you guys.
Theoretically,
it works. Yes.
Because Steph Curry, all-time great. He's still playing really well. They've got Kuminga. They've got Pajemski, who just made the all-rookie team.
Good luck. I think anybody pronounces that name, says it like five different ways.
So with those two, right, they've got a good young couple of players.
Yeah, but
so theoretically, Lauri Markkanen would be kind of the bridge that would extend the window, allow them to continue to be a very competitive team once Steph Curry hangs up his laces.
The problem, if the Jazz are involved in this, Danny wants one or both of those guys in return for Lowry.
So that's the tough part that makes it pretty unlikely to happen in my mind. But no, if you're any team in the NBA who is able to maybe make a trade, you've got to be calling Lowry. That's just smart business.
But here's the thing about it. We've seen what Danny Ainge has done.
Yes. No, he's not going to take Lowry. He's not going to take a
below
deal,
market value.
Right. Yeah. Below market value. He's not even going to take a market value deal from Lowry Markkanen.
He wants the Godfather.
He's going to rip you off.
There's a reason why he's named Trader Danny. Danny, that's his nickname.
So, it's going to be interesting to see how things unfold. We did kind of learn recent details. Lauri Markkanen is not eligible for an extension until August 6th.
Yep.
And so that makes it unlikely that a deal will be made before then. A team is not going to trade for Lowry with essentially 1 year left on his deal. They're going to wait for the extension to be made. So, yeah, if there's any Lowry news, it will likely come around then once that extension is signed. But I do think it's worth pointing out that the Jazz do not need to trade Lowry. They're in no rush to trade Lowry. No. They're not going to trade Lowry just to trade him. They will only execute this move if they get an offer that absolutely blows them away. Like I said, if they are just completely, absolutely ripping somebody off, where they get a deal where they're like, oh my gosh, this team is so stupid for offering this. Of course, we have to take them up on it.
Yeah. Well, and the other thing about it is you look at the way Danny has operated. Yeah, he's not in any rush to make a deal. This is not teams calling the Jazz saying, hey, we're going to give you a bunch of spare parts and we're done, right? Danny's like,
you're right.
No.
Yeah.
He will sit back and he'll let it roll. Because the thing about it is, he is a very good player.
Yeah.
Lowry is a, and I was on with Ben Anderson earlier this week on the show that you produced, Jake and Ben, and we're in agreement that he is a all NBA caliber player.
Yeah, certainly.
And is that fit with the Jazz timeline? Maybe not perfectly, but at the same time, keeps you pretty competitive. And why would you just jettison that for nothing?
Right. Like I said, they don't have to make a move just to make a move. The Donovan and Rudy situation was a little different in where they had tried it for several seasons and it just wasn't working. And they had to do something instead of just writing it out because it clearly was never going to work.
Yeah.
So that was a little bit of a different scenario in which they had to make the move to blow that roster up. This is a lot different. Lowry wants to be here. At least that's what it seems like, right?
Sure.
Who knows how long he wants to sit through a rebuild where he is entering the prime of his career. Mm-hmm. So there definitely is the possibility that one day he could say, you know, I do want to go to a place where I can start contending for championships while I'm in my prime and able to contribute the most that I possibly can. But at the same time, maybe he is perfectly fine with sitting through a tank. That's not out of the realm of possibility with Lowry Markkanen's character and what we've seen so far off the court from him and his personality. So there definitely is the possibility that he says, yeah, I'll undergo one more tanking season. We'll get a good draft pick hopefully next year and then maybe execute a trade to add another big piece.
Well, and the other thing about it is he is a guy that enjoys being in Utah. Now, we talk all the time on sports radio here about guys who want to be here, guys who don't want to be here. He seems to, as you mentioned, has embraced everything that Utah is. And that there's something to be said for that.
Right. It's hard to bring stars to this market. It's hard to bring high-level plays to this market. We know that, and that's just the unfortunate reality. Whether your thoughts are, you know, whatever they are on Salt Lake City as a city compared to other big cities, you know, it's hard to bring stars in. So, yeah, when you get one that wants to be here and he genuinely enjoys it here and he's got a smile on his face when he's in all these marketing videos, going on hikes with Ryan Smith, promoting the new logo, like, that's fun. And you don't want to let that go. You don't want to have to say goodbye to that.
The interesting part will be, as the Jazz move forward here, is how much of a – I'm trying to say, how much of a dynamic do they have at play here of, yes, you want to keep your stars happy, but executing the plan, the long-range plan that I'm sure Danny Ainge, Justin Zanuck, Ryan Smith is the team owner, that they all have in mind.
Doing what's best for the organization.
Sure, and if Lowry fits with that, great. I just think that Danny's willing. Yeah, he's willing to dangle Lowry out there.
Yeah,
because
why wouldn't you? Again, like I said, any team that's smart would be calling for Lowry. If you're Danny Ainge, if you're smart, you're going to be dangling him to see if you can rip somebody off.
Yeah,
and if you can, like, if you think about what the Jazz got in exchange for Donovan Mitchell
and Rudy Gobert,
but Donovan Mitchell mainly, they got several picks. Mm-hmm. And they've got Lowry Markkanen, they got Colin Sexton, two players that they were able to rehab, essentially, because they had kind of fizzled out. They weren't living up to expectations. They were able to rehab and revitalize their careers here in Salt Lake City.
Yeah.
Colin Sexton is a budding star. Lowry Markkanen is a star. Okay, so if you're able to flip Lowry Markkanen then into even more picks and then potentially another player or two that you can do the same thing to and turn into a budding young star, that's what you have to do.
Now, the interesting part will be
They have six guys they've drafted in the last 2 years, three from each of these last two NBA drafts. I am interested to see which of those develop. Now, I think we already have an idea of what some of these guys are.
Yeah.
And upcoming, by the way, Jazz Summer League, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Oh, yeah.
Right across the street from us here.
We will have basketball.
Yeah, we will have hoops. I know it's kind of crazy to consider, but we will have that happening. And if you want to tune in, we'll have the games here for you on the KSL Sports Zone. But I'm interested to see what they look like. Because this Jazz Summer League roster, it's stacked.
Yeah, probably one of the best Summer League rosters ever. No, Keontae George is great.
Yeah. I think you already know what Keontae George is.
Yeah. Taylor Hendricks, everybody's expecting him to see a leap forward.
Yeah.
And if he does take that leap, he's going to be a really good player. Everybody's, of course, excited to see Isaiah Collier, Kyle Filipowski. Cody Williams is another player that is raw and needs maybe another season or two to develop. But obviously, we're excited about him for a reason. Right? So yeah. there's a lot of young talent on this roster that has the potential to turn into something. Now, whether or not they do, of course, that's yet to be seen. But if you think of throwing darts at a board, that's what the draft essentially is. And if you got six draft picks over the last two seasons, I'm going to say odds are you hit two out of those six, and then maybe another two can be solid contributors, right?
Yeah, well, here's the thing. Not every draft pick is going to become a franchise player.
Right.
In fact, very few of them relative to how many picks there are become that. But the bigger point to me, as you mentioned, is how many of those guys can you hit on where they can play a role for your team?
Yeah.
I look at a guy, okay, let's use Taylor Hendricks, for example. Taylor Hendricks may not become a premier wing player for you, but his skill set indicates that, in my opinion, at minimum, he's a rotation piece who is going to be a 3-and-D guy for you.
Yeah, and that's very valuable. I mean, look at what Mikal Bridges is, really.
Well, look what Mikal Bridges got in terms of the trade market.
Right. He's not a huge, he's not a star player by any means, I wouldn't say, but I mean, he's essential to any team that wants to make a push for the title, and that's what you need.
That's why the Jazz pursued him, if you believe the reports out there.
Yeah, that's what puts teams over the top, is having those guys that aren't quite star-level players, but they have a very specific role, and they do that well.
Yeah, you need those guys.
Yeah. So if you're able to take multiple shots at the draft and fill many of those needs on your roster, then keep doing that. And that's what obviously fans were let down by the big game hunting quote from Danny Ainge, and that never turned into anything. Obviously, they tried. But at the end of the day, if the Jazz aren't making these big trades, they still have several picks every single season for the next, 6 years, right?
Yeah.
So just keep taking shots, because the more shots at the draft you have, the higher of a chance you have of finding these players that either they're going to be a star or a really, really solid role player.
And we know that players are going to get upset with where they're at. And there could be a star player that comes on the market at some point that the Jazz are like, hey, that's a guy, let's go get him. And then you have the assets to execute a deal. The thing about it is, I feel like there are Jazz fans out there who have decided the Jazz have put all of their eggs in one basket.
Which is completely wrong. That's the exact opposite. Yeah,
the exact opposite.
They have their eggs in every basket.
Yeah. They have multiple baskets with multiple options to do whatever.
And that's what Danny Ainge wants, is just flexibility. The flexibility to keep taking shots in the draft, the flexibility to stand idly by and wait for somebody to demand a trade and say, hey, look at all these picks that we have.
Well, and here's the thing. Danny Ainge, I think, taught the franchise a very, very good lesson, his very first draft in charge. Remember, they were mortgaged to the hilt, to use that example. Like, they had gone in on a bunch of these deals for these guys, hoping that the Donovan-Rudy dynamic, the guys they put around them, would get them to be able to elevate them. They went into that draft, and if you believe the stories out there, the people I've talked to told me this exactly. Danny said, kind of looked at everybody, because they didn't really have anything going on.
Yeah.
Sitting there on draft night, he said, is this fun? This fun for you guys?
Because they didn't have a first-round pick.
They didn't have anything.
Right.
He's like, is this fun? And they're kind of like, no.
It's not fun. What's the point? Right? So, if you don't have any picks, what's the point of being in the draft?
He's gone back and revamped it all, where he said, yes, you guys pushed all in on this option, and it didn't work out. Well, guess what? We're gonna open it back up here.
Yeah.
We're going to collect draft picks. We're going to have young players. We've got some players that we've acquired via trades for the star players you had that look like pieces.
They could be stars themselves.
Yes. There are multiple avenues they could go. If you believe the reporting, they were going to go after Mikal Bridges. And if they were to do that, they thought they might have a chance at Paul George.
Yeah, which is fine.
If you had a Paul George, Mikal Bridges, Lauri Markkanen trio with Colin Sexton as your fourth guy.
Yeah. That's a good roster.
They're a pretty talented team.
Yeah. So, and it sucks that that didn't work out. Yeah. It sucks that that never came to be. But that's where the Jazz are at, is mm-hmm. they have the flexibility to be in the conversation for those types of moves. And it is hard sitting here idly by because we as fans want them to win, and we want it now. But the reality is, like, it's the Jazz have – we've been lucky that the Jazz are one of the winningest franchises in sports. Even though they've never won a championship, their percentage, their win percentage is up there all time.
And if you're of a certain age, you were very spoiled because Donovan Mitchell, Rudy Gobert, they wanted a pretty high clip.
Yeah.
But they pale in comparison to the eras of Darren Williams, Carlos Boozer, Mehmet Okur, that trio, and even going back to the statues, as PK likes to call them.
Yeah, so in bigger picture, right, these last two seasons have sucked. They haven't been fun to sit by and watch.
To watch them pull the plug at the trade deadline two seasons in a row? No, it's no fun.
It's not fun. But the reality is that it's only been two horrible seasons in, like, the last, what, we can say 10 years comfortably, right?
They've cycled up and down a little bit, but yeah, they've been fairly competitive consistently for 50, of the 50 years the Jazz have been a franchise, 40 of those years have been, I'd say, decently competitive.
Right. Fun enough to garner interest, fan.
But the last two, they've pulled the plug twice in two seasons.
And and it sucks, and we don't know how much longer this rebuild thing is going to last, and that's kind of the uncertainty that fans want an answer two is how much longer can we expect this team to be bad for? But going back to Danny Ainge and maintaining flexibility, he's perfectly fine taking these shots in the draft and developing the young players. And maybe that's going to take another two or three seasons before these guys develop the way that they're going to. But if that's your backup plan, that's not a bad backup plan to have.
Yeah. I'm interested to see where this ultimately ends up.
Yes.
Because
10 years from now, what does it look like?
And it's going to be a fascinating case study to look back on it. But when you're kind of in the weeds, like right now in it, I get it's frustrating.
It's hard.
And trust me, we work in sports media. When the Jazz are not competitive, it's not fun.
When I'm sitting here in that studio producing the Jazz games night in, night out, and it's like, why is Talen Horton-Tucker driving to the basket and turning the ball over every other possession?
Yeah.
No, it's not fun.
No, it's not. But so it will be curious to see where they go with this, but I'm still intrigued.
There's hope. There's a light at the end of the tunnel, and maybe it's really far away. Maybe it's farther away than it seems, but it's intriguing, like you said.
It feels like there are moves that are still to come that may tear this down before they build it back up. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, if they trade Lowry Markkanen away.
And that would the tear down? That's absolutely a tear down
that's
move.
On the table.
Yeah. See, be interesting. All right. We will take a time out here. We'll come back. We'll wrap up this edition of the Saturday show, coming up next, right here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone. Welcome back to the Saturday show here on 97.5, the KSL Sports Zone. All right. We got Clint Topete, our good friend, longtime listener. I call him he listens all the time. Got a great question here, and it's something that we have not touched on quite yet. I said this, your QB conversation got me wondering if Bryson Barnes will stay at Utah State or transfer now. Now, the news is Blake Anderson has been placed on leave with the intent to fire him.
Yeah, intent not to bring him back.
They got 2 weeks, essentially, for him to respond. Now, he has retained some pretty high-powered lawyers, and I think it'll come to it. There's a number that both sides are willing to spend on a buyout for him to make him go away. I would just, if you're an Aggie fan right now who is holding out hope that Blake Anderson might be back as your head coach, I would not hold that hope.
No, no, no. He's definitely not coming back. This is just crazy news for Utah State football, basically having the rug pulled out from underneath them a month and a half before the season starts. Like, this is crazy, this whole situation. But you're right, players get a, what is it, 30-day transfer window?
Now, that will not kick in until he is actually fired.
Okay, so that's...
Because he's on this two-week window of them. So once he is actually let go by the university, that will open a 30-day window for Utah State football players to pursue if they want to go into the transfer portal.
So by then, that'll basically be 30 weeks or 30 days before the season starts.
And getting into any other school at that point seems like not going to happen.
No. Yeah, odds are I doubt they're going to lose much talent.
It's not because those guys don't want to go.
Right. It's just impossible to get enrolled in another school that quickly.
Yeah, and the other thing is a lot of these rosters, they've gone through two transfer portal cycles already.
Yeah.
They've brought in their players. They filled out their 85 scholarship allotments.
The coaching staff probably doesn't want to bring in players right before the season like that after they've gone through all spring football and then their summer stuff and training camp is right around the corner.
But, yeah, as Clint talks about, is Bryson Barnes, is he going to stay at USU? I think he's stuck.
Yeah. I think if Bryson was going to transfer, he would have when they said that he wasn't going to be the starter.
Sure, and he probably would have gone after it, yeah, and looked at other opportunities. The thing about Bryson is he is an extremely high-level backup.
Yeah.
And that's not a bad thing to have. It's not a bad thing to be either.
Right.
He did it at Utah, the pig farmer. We love him. Did some really good things. If he wanted to be a true number one quarterback, in my mind, he needed to go to the FCS level.
Yeah.
Go to SUU. Go to Utah Tech. Go to Weber.
Right.
Idaho State.
If he wanted the guaranteed shot at being the guy, he went to Utah State where they had Petras.
Yes,
and then
Spencer
they
Petras,
had
yeah.
McKay Hillstead at the time.
Now McKay Hillstead's in Provo.
Yeah, they announced Spencer Petras as the starter. Yeah. Hillstead said, okay, I lost out on the starter job. I want to go somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
Again, if Bryson Barnes was going to transfer at any point, I think that would have been his time when they said that he was not going to be the starter. But you're right. He's a good level high-level backup, especially at the Mountain West level. I mean, he made some plays against some really good Pac-12 schools.
He came into that Rose Bowl and went for a touchdown almost immediately.
Well, he came in the first game of the season last year. First snap of the season was a touchdown.
Goes deep.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
So I'm more than confident in his ability to back up Petras at Utah State.
I just feel for Utah State because
it's heartbreak. It's heartbreak right before the season starts. It's so hard.
Now, the interesting part is how they're going to go forward here, because there is some thought that they will let this ride with the interim coaching staff this season, obviously. You're not going to hire a new head coach, but I wonder how much turnover with the roster will occur when the portal opens again. Now, there could be some guys who still decide to leave once this deal is done to let Blake Anderson go.
Once that 30-day window opens.
There will probably be some guys who will leave.
There could be. Yeah, if they can make it work, which is going to be extremely difficult to do, I wouldn't be surprised if players leave.
The interesting part will be, okay, when the portal window opens back up, which will be in December, that's when the next portal window will open. Okay, will Utah State have a new head coach in place at that point? I hope they will, because the weird thought about this is Utah State is going to be the first team in the market for a head coach in the upcoming coaching cycle. It always happens.
Yeah.
And they'll be able to essentially kind of evaluate throughout the season, look at options out there. And if Diana Sabo and the department up there, the athletic department at Utah State, is doing things the right way, they will have somebody in place in theory by the time the regular season finale is wrapping up. They will have somebody in place. So that person can hit the ground running, hit the transfer portal cycle, but at the same time, try and keep as many of the guys on the roster in place in Logan.
That's if
it all goes according to plan, yes.
Which we know never happens.
So there's a very interesting case study to be made of this. Is, okay, you fired coach beginning of July.
Yeah.
And I'm saying fired because he's not coming back to Utah State.
There's no way he's coming back.
There's a reason why Tom Mars is representing him.
Yeah.
They're just trying to find a certain number.
There are some bridges that are burned.
Yeah, there's a number out there in terms of money on that buyout that both sides are going to be like, done deal.
Yeah.
So they'll be in the cycle for a new head coach. The interesting part will be, okay, how much of this roster can you keep intact?
Yeah. Yeah, and there's some talent up there in Logan.
Oh, no doubt.
No doubt.
I look at Ike Larson.
Jalen Royals. Probably their two best players.
Yeah.
They've got some good linemen, good defensive linemen as well.
And you want to keep as much of that there as you can.
Yeah, always. It's always a struggle anyways because of the transfer portal, because of these bigger fish in the pond poaching these smaller schools. But, yeah, it's going to be a really, really interesting season for Utah State with this all happening right now.
Yeah, so interesting stuff. All right, we are out of time. Any other thoughts real quick before we go?
No, this is a fun show.
Yeah. Well, we will be back next week with the Saturday show, but also keep it right here on The Zone all week long with plenty of coverage of everything going on. We got Jazz Summer League Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. We got Big 12 Media Days Tuesday, Wednesday as well. It's going to be a big week on the station.
Yeah, it's one of our biggest weeks of the year having these media days.
Mountain West media days
are next week as well.
Hey, Utah State, they're going
to
be.
Yeah, can't wait to see what happens, what we hear from Utah State. Odds are it's going to be nothing, but.
Probably. All right. Well, anyways, keep it locked here on The Zone. And of course, big thank you to all of you for tuning in. For everybody involved on today's show, we got a big crew today. So big thank you to everybody for tuning in. We'll catch
Thanks,
you guys
Brett.
Next
Thanks,
week.
Parker.
Yeah, obviously, big thank you to you guys. We'll be back next week right here on The Saturday Show.